टुडे वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट थोरेको एब्डोमिनल डायफ्राम। इट इज़ अ चीफ मसल ऑफ क्वाइट रेस्पिरेशन। इट सेपरेट्स थोरेसिक एंड एब्डोमिनल कैविटीज एंड इट गिव्स पैसेज टू द नंबर ऑफ स्ट्रक्चर्स। इट इज़ इनर्वेटेड बाय द फ्रेनिक नर्व and it develops in the region of the neck. It is a dome-shaped muscle. The muscle fibers form the periphery. They arise from the circumference of thoracic outlet and inserted into the central tendon. The muscle fibers of diaphragm are grouped into three parts: the sternal fibers, costal fibers, and the lumbar fibers. The sternal part arises by two fleshy slips from the back of xiphoid process. The costal part arises from the inner surface of the costal cartilages and adjacent part of the lower six ribs, which may interdigitate with the transversus abdominis muscle. And the lumbar part arises from the medial and lateral lumbocostal arches as well as from the lumbar vertebra by means of right and left crus. The medial lumbocostal arch is also known as the medial arcuate ligament. It is a tendinous arch in the upper part of fascia covering psoas major muscle. Medially it is attached to the side of body of L1 and laterally it is attached to the front of transverse process of L1 vertebra. Same way, the lateral lumbocostal arch, which is also known as lateral arcuate ligament, it is a tendinous arch in the fascia covering upper part of quadratus lumborum muscle. Medially it is attached to the transverse process of L1 in front aspect and laterally it is attached to the lower border of 12th rib. The right crus of the diaphragm is larger and stronger compared to the left crus. It may be because it has to pull down lever during inspiration. It arises from the anterolateral surfaces of body of upper three lumbar vertebra and intervening intervertebral disc. The left crus arises from the corresponding parts of the upper two lumbar vertebra. The medial margin of both the crura, right and left crus, it forms a tendinous arch across the front of aorta and it is called as the median arcuate ligament. From the circumferential origin described, the fibers of diaphragm arch upwards and inwards and they form the right and the left dome of the diaphragm. The right dome is higher compared to the left dome. In full expiration, it reaches at the level of 4th intercostal space. The left dome reaches at the level of 5th rib. The central tendon lies at the level of lower end of sternum at the level of 6th costal cartilage. The downward concavity of the dome is occupied by the lever on the right side and by the fundus of the stomach on the left side. The medial fibers of the right crus run upward and to the left. They encircle the esophagus. In general, all the fiber converge toward the central tendon for the insertion. The central tendon of the diaphragm lies below the pericardium and fuses with it. This tendon is trilobar in shape. made up of three leaflets. The middle leaflet is triangular in shape and directed toward the xiphoid process, whereas the right and left leaflets are tongue-shaped and directed backwards. The central area consists of four well-marked diagonal bands. The point of the decussation lies just in front of the esophagus. There are three large or main openings in the diaphragm: the aortic opening, esophageal opening, and vena cava opening. The aortic opening is osseo-aponeurotic and it lies at the level of lower border of 12th thoracic vertebra. The esophageal opening lies in the muscular part of the diaphragm at the level of lower border of 10th thoracic vertebra. And the vena cava opening lies in the central tendon of the diaphragm at the level of 8th thoracic vertebra. The aortic opening transmits the aorta, azygous vein, and thoracic duct. The esophageal opening transmits esophagus, right and left vagus, as well as the esophageal branches of the left gastric artery. And the vena cava opening transmits the inferior vena cava, the right phrenic nerve, and the lymphatics of liver. Apart from three major openings, there are many small openings in the diaphragm. Each crus of the diaphragm is pierced by the greater and lesser splanchnic nerves. The left crus, apart from both the splanchnic nerves, is also pierced by the hemiazygous vein. The sympathetic chain passes from thorax to abdomen behind the medial arcuate ligament, whereas subcostal nerves and vessels passes behind the lateral arcuate ligament. The superior epigastric vessels and some lymphatics passes between the origin of the diaphragm, between the landmarks xiphoid process and seventh costal cartilage. This space is known as Leri space or foramen of Morgagni. The musculophrenic vessels pierce the diaphragm at the level of 9th costal cartilage. Apart from this, the intercostal nerves and vessels as well as left phrenic nerve also passes through the diaphragm. The superior relations of diaphragm include pleura, lungs, as well as pericardium, whereas the inferior relations of the diaphragm include the peritoneum, liver, the fundus of the stomach, spleen, both the kidneys and suprarenal glands. The diaphragm is having sensory and motor nerve supply. It is supplied motor fibers by the phrenic nerve via ventral rami of C3, C4 and C5. Whereas for the central part of the diaphragm, the phrenic nerve is the sensory one, and for the peripheral part of the diaphragm, lower six thoracic nerves are the sensory nerves. The chief actions of diaphragm: the first one is it is a principal muscle of inspiration. On contraction, the diaphragm descends, thereby increasing the vertical diameter of thorax. The excursion of diaphragm is about 1.5 cm during quiet breathing, and it is about 6 to 10 cm during deep inspiration. Diaphragm also helps in all the expulsive acts like sneezing, coughing, laughing, crying, vomiting, micturition, defecation, and parturition, etc. It also exerts the sphincteric action around the lower end of esophagus. The level of the diaphragm in our body differ in the different position. The level of diaphragm is highest in the supine position, lowest in the sitting position, and intermediate in standing position. The important applied or clinical anatomy of the diaphragm includes the hiccups, referred shoulder tip pain, paralysis of diaphragm, eventration of the diaphragm, and diaphragmatic hernia. The hiccups means edgy. They are the results of spasmodic contraction of the diaphragm. Hiccups are of two types, central and peripheral. The peripheral hiccups are due to the local irritation of the diaphragm or its nerve, whereas central hiccups are due to the irritation of the hiccup center in the medulla. The pain due to the irritation of the phrenic nerve is referred to the tip of shoulder, because phrenic nerve and supraclavicular nerve both are formed by C3, C4 and C5 nerve roots. In unilateral paralysis of diaphragm, the paralyzed side moves opposite to the normal side, which is called as paradoxical movements. The eventration of the diaphragm is a condition in which the diaphragm is pushed upward due to the defect in the musculature of the left half, congenital defect in the musculature of the left half of the diaphragm. The diaphragmatic hernias include congenital and acquired. The congenital hernia could be the retrosternal, posterolateral, posterior, or central. The retrosternal hernia occurs through the gap between the xiphoid and costal origin of the diaphragm, between right lung and pleura. This gap is called as foramen of Morgagni or Larynx space. The posterolateral hernia occurs through the Bocdalex foramen, or it is also known as costovertebral trigone, in which diaphragm fails to arise from the lateral arcuate ligament, which leaves here a triangular gap, which is known as Bocdalex foramen. In the posterolateral hernia, the thoracic cavity fills up with the abdominal organs, and the child dies within few hours after the birth due to acute respiratory distress, which is caused by the abdominal viscera, which fills the left part of the chest, because this hernia is most common on the left side, and such hernia requires operation in the few hours of the life. The posterior hernia is due to failure of the development of this posterior part of the diaphragm. One or both the crura may be absent in this case, and the aorta and esophagus both will lie in a gap, but there will be no actual hernial sac. And the central hernia is very rare, most commonly left-sided, and it is a result of the rupture of fetal membranous diaphragm in the region of left dome. The acquired hernia could be traumatic, or it could be a hiatal hernia. This hiatal hernia develops through the dilated esophageal hiatus, which are of two types, the sliding hernia and rolling hernia. In the sliding hernia, the gastroesophageal junction moves upward through the esophageal hiatus into the thoracic cavity, and there is regurgitation or reflux of the acids from the stomach into the esophagus, which leads to heartburn. Whereas in case of rolling hernia, the gastroesophageal junction remains in its normal position, but the fundus of the stomach projects upwards through the esophageal hiatus into the thoracic cavity. And this condition is characterized by pain, nausea, and vomiting. So this is the basic difference between the rolling and sliding hernia. In sliding hernia, gastroesophageal junction moves upwards, whereas in rolling hernia, gastroesophageal junction retains its normal position, but the fundus of the stomach moves upwards.